Audiences, Eminencies, Excellencies, esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and a warm welcome to everyone present in this hall and to all the viewers worldwide who are watching us live on Facebook now. What describes best our meeting today and this whole endeavor is the word special. First, it's a special day because CAISEED is convening the second high-level meeting of interreligious dialogue for peace. The first high-level meeting was held in the same room in November 2014 and resulted in the very pioneering and timely initiative United Against Violence in the Name of Religion. Second, 2018 is a special date because it marks the fifth anniversary of the launching of CAISEED as a leading organization that brings together the best of the two realms, the interreligious and the intergovernmental, with strong civil society engagement. Third, it's a special gathering because CAISEED is bringing together prominent religious leaders and influential policy makers in addition to youth networks and grassroots activists. Fourth, we are entrusted with a very special task, that of formally launching the interreligious platform for dialogue and cooperation in the Arab world, and this at this critical juncture of the history of our region. Fifth, it requires a special insight and collective reasoning to be able to reflect on the successes of CAISEED and to draw lessons from the challenges faced when we operate in the complex world of today. Finally, I have the very special duty of reminding our inspirational speakers today to observe the 5 to 7 minute time for their interventions. It's a very difficult task. I personally appeal to all of you esteemed guests to facilitate my task of ensuring the smooth proceedings of our agenda items today, and thank you. I would like to invite our speakers for the first session. I would like to invite His Excellency Faisal bin Muammar, His Excellency Dr. Mikhail Linhart, His Excellency Nizar Madani, Her Excellency Ms. Belen Alfaro, His Excellency Bishop Mikhail Ayoso, His All Holiness Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew, His Excellency Dr. Muhammad bin Abdul Karim Al Isa, His Excellency Nasser Abdul Aziz Al Nasser, His Excellency Yusuf bin Ahmed Al Uthaymeen. Please take your seats. Thank you. Our first speaker in this session is His Excellency Faisal bin Abdul Rahman bin Muammar, CAISEED Secretary General. Welcome, Your Excellency.
Well, guten Tag. Good morning. Assalamu alaikum. Your All Holiness, Eminences, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I am honored to welcome you to the King Abdullah bin Abdul Aziz International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue, KAISID. As we gather here for the second high-level meeting to promote peaceful coexistence and common citizenship around the world, I would like to offer special thanks to former President of the Republic of Austria, President Fischer. Who joins us here today, I am grateful for this for valuable and continued support of our mission. Since its inception, KAISID has taken a leading role in advocating for dialogue for religious leaders and political leaders to work hand in hand to find common solutions to the challenges of violent extremism. Today, more and more policymakers have heard us. They recognize the reality that to counter division, to promote coexistence, and to foster the values of common citizenship, they must include religious leaders as supporting partners in this process. Policymakers can benefit from the knowledge and the grassroots influence of religious leaders, and in turn, both secular and religious leaders find common ground and shared values. We must not fear religion, as it is part of the solution. The root causes of violent extremism can be more effectively removed when religion's true intent is widely and correctly understood. 3 years ago, we united here in Vienna in solidarity to preserve religious diversity and social cohesion around the world, and to reject any attempt to monopolize religion to justify violence. Since then, we have worked with religious leaders and religious communities to promote their capacity to build bridges of understanding and cooperation between their communities. In the face of crisis and loss, I have witnessed religious leaders courageous and stand against prejudice and hatred. They have the power to engage the moderate majority of the faithful. Our mission is to enable the moderate majority to take a step towards people of other religions and cultures, to understand and respect the others. In dialogue, the international community and religious leaders have in the past 3 years established a best practice of partnership between policymakers and religious leaders to develop concrete, lasting solutions. Around the world, religious leaders are at the forefront of rebuilding coexistence between religious communities and helping to foster the value of shared citizenship. That vision of interreligious cooperation is KAISID's foundation. The board who are convened here today includes renowned advocates for interreligious cooperation representing Buddhist, Christian, Hindu, Muslims, and the Jewish communities. Also, many members of the Advisory Council join us today, comprising religious leaders and advocates representing diverse religions. The center receives vital support from its founding countries, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, the Republic of Austria, the Kingdom of Spain, and the Vatican, as a founding observer. And I also thank these nations' representatives for their presence here today. At our first meeting in 2014, in this room, you agreed upon an action plan that KAISID put into practice. Our track record shows we put your decisions into measurable action. You ask us to support young people, to use social media to recruit followers for dialogue, not for hate. Young people can and will change the world, and we must give them the tools to make sure that change is positive. We have responsibility to use social media as an opportunity to grant youth a model solidarity. We can utilize this media to help young people appreciate religious identity and respect diversity. When they see others as peers, not stereotypes, they will reject divisive rhetoric. Their social media dialogue will offer their young peers an accurate and sympathetic understanding of young people of different religions, not false and biased picture. In the past 3 years, we train about 400 young religious communities, leaders of different religions and denominations from around the Arab world. These young people are in turn training other young people. Every day, the group of trainees is increasing. Now they are connected across the region and will together launch social media campaigns. These campaigns will offer many social media users a perspective that respects all religions and identities. You also ask us to support the Islamic and Christian educational institutions that train future religions leaders to introduce interreligious dialogue into their teaching. We launched the first network of religious Muslim and Christian faculties and institutes in the Arab world. This network will develop a common curriculum in interreligious dialogue training for these religious institutions. The core group of 16 institutions will exchange faculty and the students, as well as expertise to bind them together. One of the faculty members told us that the network made it possible for his institutions to have its very first meeting with Christian faculty to discuss how to teach dialogue in seminary school. And finally, in the past 3 years, we have established interreligious platforms in the Central African Republic, in Myanmar, and in Nigeria. Allow me to have some water, just very long speech. I wasn't planning to speak. I will be the first one to break the rules of 7 minutes. But as the Secretary General, I am allowed to break the rules. In each of these countries, as well in Beirut, we have posted country experts. The country experts who I am pleased to say are with us today are in constant contact with their religious community and governmental partners. We are very honored that the Cardinal of Abuja, Nigeria, and the Sultan of Sokoto, as well as the President of the Christian Association of Nigeria, who are taking part in this meeting. They are leading figures in the Christian-Muslim dialogue platform in Nigeria that we support. The Nigerian-Muslim Christian platform speaks out against ethnic and religious violence. They have drafted legislation to outlaw all hate preaching by any denomination. The legislation is now in deliberation in Nigerian parliament. We are also grateful that two of the founders of the interreligious platform in Central African Republic have traveled to this conference. We are proud to support their platform. The platform undertakes projects to rebuild trust and peace in the country. For instance, one project uses dialogue to help people who have been driven from their homes in the recent conflict to return to the neighborhood they had fled. At this point, I wish to extend our thanks to the United Religions Initiative, one of the world's largest interreligious NGOs, which granted the center the 2018 Peace Prize for its work in interreligious dialogue in Africa. In Myanmar, the Dialogue Center supports the NGO, the Peaceful Myanmar Initiative, and here today, thank to the three members of the initiative who have traveled from Myanmar to be with us. Their platform is young, yet it successfully organizes national interreligious conferences. In a breakthrough, They have provided intensive interreligious dialogue training to Buddhist masters from the leading Burmese Buddhist academic institutions. Our work also includes cooperation with international organizations as the United Nations. It is a pleasure to welcome to this conference our good friend, Adama Dyang, the UN Secretary General's Special Advisor for the Prevention of Genocide. Special Advisor Dyang, the World Council of Churches and the Network of Religious and Traditional Peacemakers are some of our partners to whom we are grateful for their shared commitment and efforts. The center was privileged to contribute to the Global Action Plan with these partners. In brief, the Global Action Plan provides religious leaders the capacity to prevent incitement leading to genocide. After we worked together for 2 years, gathering over 200 religious leaders in meetings around the world, the Global Action Plan was launched by the United Nations Secretary General, and we are now engaged in supporting its implementation. Now we extend our hands to you. We invite you all to support and celebrate the launch of the first interreligious platform for dialogue cooperation in the Arab world. The platform will offer Christians and Muslims in the Arab countries the means to establish cooperation of understanding to secure and strengthen common citizenship. The platform can bridge the gap between communities. Never before did religious leaders of different communities jointly work across national borders in a coordinated manner. We hope this platform will change that. We will build partnerships between religious leaders across the region to advocate for the protection and the preservation of the rights of all religious communities in the Arab world under the umbrella of common citizenship and equality regardless of religion, sect, or ethnicity. The unity of purpose between Christians and Muslims in vital issues, such as the common citizenship, cannot be ignored. Unity among religious leaders is the strongest message of hope that the region has seen in many years. KAISEED is here for the long term. We will help these religious leaders build their own institutions. We are not giving a chance for peace every day. I urge you all to seize this chance. It will not be easy or fast, yet together we will build a platform that bridges nations and religious communities around the world. Once again, I welcome you again and wish you a good health, a pleasant stay in this lovely weather and the snow, and most importantly, much dialogue. Thank you very much.
ITV, Call of